We move on to a presentation by Sri T.K. Jagannathan on self-governance, which will cover yoga, pranayama and meditation. A very quick look at Sri T.K. Jagannathan's background. A very distinguished corporate executive, a postgraduate chemical engineer from the Indian Institute of Science, 20 years in Larsen & Toubro, Bombay Marketing Capital Equipment, 10 years in Thermax, Hindustan Dow Oliver, retired as Vice President Marketing, Deutsche Babcock, 1 year in Qatar due diligence contract. He retired at 58 and did a course in Vedanta and Yoga at Shivananda Ashram at Rishikesh. He has been teaching pranayama and therapeutic yoga for 15 years in India and Canada. He is an ex-editor of the Senior Citizens Post, a monthly magazine, an executive committee member of the Federation of the Senior Citizens Forums of Karnataka. He has written a book on the philosophy of Ganesha, book of Purandaradasa songs, translated into Tamil. He has been translating Professor Alan Kashyap's Vedic books to Tamil. 15 books have already been released. He has written booklets on diabetes and arthritis. His wife is also a yoga teacher for 25 years. They have a son and a daughter living in the USA and Canada. They are the proud grandparents of 3 girls and a boy. And he says his hobbies are singing and cooking. I am yet to hear him singing, but I look forward to taste his cooking very soon. Now he is here with his recipe of self-governance, yoga, pranayama and meditation. With great pleasure, I present to you, ladies and gentlemen, Sri T.K. Jagannathan.
Ladies and gentlemen, namaskara. Good morning. Hari Om. The task given to me is to bring Ganges in a bottle. I have brought Ganges for you from Banaras. That's the task. This is a subject, an ocean. What we are going to see is not even an atom in these 30-40 minutes. I was a corporate man for nearly 35 years. Then there are a lot of kingmakers in the world. Our Professor Kashyap is a kingmaker, and he has made me a spiritual man and a Vedic man. The governance word in the corporate level, I was used to it, but the governance is a word which has come from to govern. Everything in the universe is governed by someone or something. You cannot see any object or a living being without a part of governance in it. You go out of this hall, you see the sky, you see the sun shining. The sun has been given a definite duty of going in an orbit in a particular speed, in a particular level. He doesn't differentiate between a death procession or a marriage procession. I will only give life for the good. No. He enlightens everything. You go in the evening, you see the moon, celestial objects and everything. For thousands and thousands of years, they are all in the same place, orbiting in the same speed. How? There is a celestial governance. Suppose if the sun thinks today, oh, something is happening in the Capitol Hotel, in the conference room, so many people are chanting Veda. Let me see what they are talking about me. If he comes to have a peep in us, can you just imagine what can happen to us? But he doesn't do it. It is a celestial governance. He keeps up his work. You come down one level to our worldly level. UN is the CEO. The head of UN is the CEO. He has a council of members from various countries. They do the world governance. It's not succeeding to the level which we expect it to succeed. That's a pity. It's a human greed. You come down to the third level, a country level, a prime minister or a president as a CEO with a council of ministers. They form the rules and regulations where a country has to go, what policies you must have. That's the worldly governance. You come down to the next step, corporate governance. All the countries have to have companies, production, then services, either a private sector or a government sector. They have to have governance. There is a CEO, there is a board of chairman, and then the board of directors, and they formulate rules and regulations where the company has to go. Finally, we descend on the self-governance. It is a human being. A country or the world is not made of inanimate objects, they are made of human beings. All the beings created by the supreme power. As the celestial governance is like a supreme power, the celestial governance should come from inside for the self-governance. So we have several levels of governance. Only to call it a corporate governance, at other levels there is no governance, is not the right thing to do. And each one of us, the beings born, have to ask ourselves time and again, who am I? Why am I here for? Is this the purpose of getting up in the morning, eating the food, and the factory processing the food and rejecting the waste, going to the company, earning money, working for the children? Is it our purpose, or is there a higher goal in my life? But self-governance is the exercise of power or control over oneself without external interference, but we have to place the public interest in front of us, ahead of us, than our self-interest. So every individual has to have a goal without which we cannot progress. Whether an individual expresses about the goal or not, it's up to him. A goal which he thinks will make him happy, will acquiring a lot of money, a house, a car, family, wife, children, this should not be the goal. Of course they are the goals, they are happiness, but they are called Vishaya Sukha. The Vedas call it Vishaya Sukha. You just remove that, yeah. What does it happen? Vishaya Sukha. These are all temporary. That you think that you are getting happiness, but the moment you acquire one, why not I have a second? So there should be an ultimate goal beyond all this Vishaya Sukha. That is what is the tools for that. Is the Vedas, the scriptures, the Bhagavad Gita, and the pranayama, yoga, and the disciplines of life, how we conduct the life, that makes the difference for self-governance. Taittiriya Upanishad says, Anando Brahmeti Ananda Deva Kalvimani Bhutani Jayante. Like this mantra goes, it says, you realize the Brahman, which is the bliss, that is the ultimate. The bliss is from where all the beings, like you, me, everything is created. It is the bliss with which we live. When a man dies, he dies in the bliss, he reaches the bliss, and he becomes one with it. So where we came from Ananda, and we reach Ananda. In between is the time between the birth and the death, that is called life. And how we devise our life, it's entirely within us. So we have to look for those permanent ananda. We are ananda swarupa, we are chachit sat chit ananda, we are not the worldly possession mongers. That realization should come to us so that the self-governance becomes easier for us. Then, what is the three basic needs of human beings? They're very, very simple. They are not all these possessions what we have. We need food. We need water. We need air. We need food, but in moderation. We need water in sufficient quantity and quality. We need air which is unpolluted. I am talking of the difficult commodities to get today. The air is polluted. The water is polluted, so all of us frequently fall sick. So we have to continuously keep looking for the tools and tackles with which we can handle these vagaries of the life, which is affecting our health, which is affecting our ananda. Only a healthy body can support a healthy mind, and only a healthy mind can direct the healthy body. Body health and mental health are two brings in our progress. This realization has to dawn upon us at the earliest part in our life, and we have to start working on it. Ananda is something you have to work for. Ananda is something which comes to you. A person wants to go to Mysore, he cleans up the car, he services the car, he takes the car, he is going for a marriage function, he is going to get a fantastic food and entertainment, everything. But halfway through, he gets into an accident, he gets injured. He was asking and you are working for Ananda, but the Dukkha has not asked, it came. So anytime Dukkha will come to us unannounced, Ananda is a thing for which you have to work, you have to make effort. You want to become a graduate, you must study, you must give exam, you must pass. You want to get a job, you must attend interview, satisfy the board, get the job. You want to get married, you have to find a spouse who is agreeable to marry you. You want to have children, you have to work for it. For everything, for every pleasure, small, big, temporary, permanent, for everything we have to work. But Dukkha in life comes to you without asking. Just without asking. Who doesn't want Ananda? Who wants Dukkha? No way. Someone comes and says that, hey, I will give you 5 crores. You say, yeah, but I will give you my cancer along with it. Will anyone ever accept? So Dukkha comes easier, it's not easier to buy Ananda. You have to work for Ananda. The tools like your Veda, scriptures, yoga and pranayama are the roots, the paths which are enlightened by the Vedic mantras. In the human being, the mind is the CEO and the Panchendriyas are the board of directors. And there are a lot of rules and regulations which is a proper way of living, we have to adapt them. The powerful tools like Veda scriptures, as I already mentioned, are with which you can govern, you have to adapt them in your life. And unfortunately, our education system in India had everything built in. But it is a British system of education which came, which has erased this culture. And today, I get a lot of WhatsApp in our spiritual group that in Britain, the prayer in a school is Gayatri Mantra. When you look at about 100 British children standing in line and chanting Gayatri Mantra, and in Netherlands, there is a hall in which there are 300 people, Dutch people, chanting Mahamrityunjaya Mantra. And in White House, 2 Americans blemishlessly, I will tell you, chanting Rudra, and Trump is standing there and watching. What are they doing and where we are heading? So we have to rethink and reset our mindset. And there are 4 major steps for an individual to easily improve his body and mind. First comes the mantra. Second comes a meditation, a dhyana. Third is the breath control. 4 is the asana posture. Though in the Ashtanga Yoga, there are 8 limbs, these 4 are very, very important. Each of the above is a ocean in the subject content. What we are going to see today is not even an atom. I am just kindling your interest so that you can pursue when you leave this hall and go out. What are mantras? Let us take the first one, mantras. Mantras are the vibrant mental revelations addressed to the cosmic forces in the celestial world and universe, governing everything, including the 5 elements, solid, liquid, air, fire and space. All of us are made of it. Everything is made up, created with that. Vayu, for example, is the god of wind, or the power of wind. It is the life energy. Making it as a, giving it as a form and a picture and making it an exclusive Hindu god is not right. He belongs to everything and everybody universally and globally. You must have the realization. Let us consider the basic mantra, Om Mantra. One thing I forgot to tell you, the basic definition of a mantra is a bridge between mind and the divinity. You have an argument with someone, you feel like cursing him, but you know you are doing right. At that time, take a breath in and mentally, couple of times, say Om mantra, you will find your mental condition changes, you are out of trouble. That is the power of Om. When I say Om, many people think they pronounce Om, Om lifelessly. That's not the two syllable Om name. Om is made of three syllables, Akara. Akara is our wakeful state. We have three Jagrati, Swapna, Swapna and Sushumna. We have three stages in our existence. Only the fully awakened stage, next is the dream stage, third is the deep sleep stage. In the fully awakened stage, we are aware of everything, this table, this chair, this body, you, your head, everything we are aware of. When you go into Swapna state, there is a transition between this wakeful awareness to the sleeping awareness. The sleeping awareness is where you have no body consciousness. You just do not know who you are. You have no ego. You have no world. You are just deep asleep, except to disturb others with your snoring. Otherwise, you have no consciousness of anything. So, Omkara is nothing but the transition in these three different stages, but it's not necessary that you have to do it at a particular time, particular place, particular way only is considered. Right now, sitting in this chair, you want to enjoy the benefit, the resonance, the vibration of your whole body. When you say you will find the resonance is from your Mooladhara Chakra to the Manipura Chakra, your stomach area and the chest area. When you say ooh, you will find the resonance and vibration in your mind and your throat area. When you say Makara, you will feel the vibration and the resonance in your throat and your Sahasra area. So all these vibrations, the resonance, every syllable of the Om mantra, gives you energy. If you want, you can join with me for a three-time Om mantra right now where you are sitting. I will request you to kindly sit straight with your back straight, with your palms on the lap. Lightly close your eye, take a deep breath in, hold it, then pronounce along with me the Omkara. Then again take a deep breath, second time pronounce the Omkara. Then again take a deep breath in, then pronounce the Omkara. After three times, you be silent for a couple of minutes, you see the enjoyment what you get in this Omkara. When you are further in this, this is called the Kundalini Chakra rising, and the energy you will feel after chanting Om for 3 or 5 or 10 times is something enormous which you only can experience in your life. So I request you to kindly put your laps on your hands on your laps and slightly close your eye. Keep your head slightly bent forward. Breathe a couple of times normally. Take a deep breath in. Slowly open your eyes and get used to your surroundings. Rub your hands, bring warmth and place it on your face. Tremendous amount of energy is produced by these vibrations of this mantra. In order not to waste the energy, we rub our palm, which becomes warm, and then we recycle the energy internally. That's a basic thing. So you see, it is so easy that Omkara can give you so much of energy, so much of calmness, so much of internal resonance and vibration. Then you move to the next level of, this is a single three syllable mantra. Then we have the Gayatri mantra and the Mahamrityunjaya mantra, which is directly from the Vedas. You can imagine those mantras with 24 syllables and different chandas, how much more energy it can give you, provided you apply your mind, determine, and chant those mantras the way they have to be chanted. So, since a short of time, all of you are already introduced to these two, three mantras. Let's proceed skipping them. Then the next is Veda came from the Sanskrit root Vid. Vid means knowledge. Ayur Veda. Ayuhu plus Veda is Ayurveda. Ayuhu means it is a life energy. Veda is the knowledge. Ayurveda is a knowledge of how to combat enemies of the life, which is diseases. That is Ayurveda. Then the Vedic astrology is makes you think of your, make you recollect your karmas, the act because of, act as per your karmas. And Vedic astrology deals with the understanding into our personal karmas. It's more of a behavioral science, how to conduct yourself in the life. So like that, Veda and yoga are very closely connected. Most of the principles of yoga, which is a later part of the human development, came basically from the Veda. Then we move to the second, meditation. It is the second aspect. You have to find your own answer for one question constantly in circulation. Whether meditation can calm your mind, or only calm mind can meditate. This is a question everybody asks. If your mind is agitated, what can I sit in a meditation? But if you don't sit in a meditation, how will you calm your mind? So this answer, each individual has to find for himself. No teacher can teach you. You have to practice. You have to enter the world of meditation and then find an answer and then adapt it in your life. But unfortunately, what happens, most of the meditation teachers, when they start, they tell the people, early in the morning, Brahma Muhurta, that is between 4 and 5, that is a deep sleeping stage for most of us. You have to find a calm and quiet place. Where do you find a calm and quiet place in the world? Put off your cell phone. No one at home should disturb you. You should not get any phone calls. You should not have any thoughts. Then you sit for meditation. You will never do meditation. Because most of the people don't find such condition. Okay, meditation is so difficult. Let me not do meditation. I strongly feel meditation is not the thing to do. Hey, can you do me a toast? Yeah, 1 minute. I'll just put it in a toaster and make a toast for you. Like that, meditation is not like a toast or an omelette or something like that which you do. Meditation has to happen. You have to become a meditator. Let it happen smoothly, silently within you. That will happen only you become a meditator. It's not necessary that you have to find a calm, quiet place and all that. That's my opinion. Okay. And if you want, you can have meditation happen right in your seat where you are sitting. Would you like to join me? Okay. Again, lightly close your eye. Sit as vertical as possible. As vertical as possible in your chair. Leave your body and limb loose and relaxed. Lightly close your eye. Just repeat after me mentally. Travel along with me in this journey. Keep breathing normal. Keep reminding to yourself, I am nobody. I am not a son. I am not a father. I am not a boss. I am not a subordinate. I am not a husband. I am not a friend. I am not a cousin. I am nothing. I am nobody. All these hats are worn by this body. I am beyond this body. I am beyond this body. I am a pure soul. I am an Ananda. I am an Ananda Swarupa. My nature is bliss. I am a very happy person. I am nobody. Thoughts come and go. I do not care. Sounds come and go. I do not chase. The time I am sitting in meditation now is all for me. All my life I have been satisfying others. This is my time. I do not bother about the past. I am not planning anything for the future. The reality is at present. I am sitting in this place all by myself for a peace of mind. I am feeling very calm. I am feeling relaxed. I am a Shuddha Chaitanya. I am nobody. I have no worries, no thoughts. I am very happy and very relaxed. I only feel the cool breath going in, the warm breath going out. I only focus on my breath in and out. I am very happy. I am contented. I am nobody. I am myself. Slowly open your eyes, rub your palms and touch your face. This is meditation, but people will laugh. This is not as simple. Meditation is a very complicated science. It has got a lot of variations. Some people will teach Nama, Rupa, Sahita meditation. Nama means they will give you a mantra. Om Gam Ganapataye Namaha. This is mantra I am giving you, Dikha. Keep a small idol of Ganesha. Keep staring at the Ganesha. Keep chanting this mantra. First loud and then light and then mentally. Then close your eye. Visualize the Ganesha image in your mind and mentally repeat this Ganesha. This is called Nama Rupa Sahita meditation. Some people will say the image is not good. Only do Nama. I give you a mantra chapa. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Only do with the mantra. Some people say either of them is not good. You keep a candle and keep staring at the flame and then close your eye and then visualize the flame in your mind. So you take light inside the flame. Like this, several methods of meditation is there. What you have to do is to read some preliminary article and then get introduced to meditation. meditation, you can even approach the teacher, go and learn several methods of meditation, and for a few days you try all the meditation and select what is suitable for your mental frame, for the time available and when you want to do it. That is meditation. It's a very small introduction. If you want a small seed article, please leave your email ID. I will send you a seed article for meditation. It's a starting point. Then you can proceed. At any time you want, you can also contact me, and I'll be even one-to-one basis, I'll be able to help you to introduce you to meditation. But you must become a meditator. Remember, you cannot do meditation. Meditation should naturally happen within you. You should become a natural meditating human being. That's about meditation. Then we move to the next point, pranayama. Pranayama is my pet subject. My normally it takes about 5 days of full course, which I have to condense in 10 minutes now. I will attempt. Pranayama is a rhythm of yoga. Like you have a Bharatanatyam and you have a rhythm. Music as a rhythm for Bharatanatyam, for pranayama is for yogasana is a rhythm. Even for your daily life, you need not do pranayama, you can adapt pranayama. You are walking somewhere, something drops from your hand and then you bend down to pick it up. Imagine at that time you bend down, breathing in fully, you will be bloated. You will find it so difficult to go and pick up that piece of coin which is fallen in the road. Instead, when you bend to pick up that piece of coin, expel the air from inside completely, there is a vacuum inside, your body is able to bend easily and pick it up. That's pranayama. There's nothing. It's not a great Brahma Vidya for us. It's difficult to learn. You can learn and practice pranayama so easily and adapt it in your world, whether you are driving a car, whether you are a passenger in the car, whether you are in the office, whether you are at home, you are watching TV, you are reading a newspaper. Anytime you can adapt and do pranayama, you don't have to find a corner for it. Except that if your stomach is light, you will find it much easier to do. But there are certain pranayamas you can do immediately after even a wedding lunch to make your stomach lighter. Pranayama is such a wonderful science and I simply love it. And first question is asked, what is pranayama? Pranayama means, prana means it is a life energy. Ayama means to control, which gives you energy for your life. Prana, ayama. Most of us think that what we is just the oxygen. The air has got 24% oxygen, 70% nitrogen, argon, this gas and everything is there. But that's not true. The atmosphere where we are sitting now, where everywhere we go, is fully loaded with energy. Where does the energy come from? It's light energy. We are seeing a bulb there. We are seeing an AC working, we are seeing a fan working, but how do they function? There is an energy coming to it called electricity. Can we see electricity? I am able to see all of you, I am able to hear my own speech, I am able to speak. How? I cannot see any of them, but there is an energy coming to it from, there is a person inside, a CEO called the soul sitting, he is consistently giving me the energy. That is the energy. Now I call some person, I say, Professor, you'll be able to hear here. Suppose Professor is in the last row. Professor, he is not heard. Professor, then you hear. Suppose Professor is in the next hall, if he has to hear, Professor, I have to call. Like this, the sound energy which emanates from my mouth, it doesn't die. It keeps on traveling. Imagine, visualize a person who is going on a highway at a kilometer distance. He sees a small spot of light. Oh, there is a small light. He keeps going nearer, nearer, nearer. The light becomes more and more and more. That means the light energy was traveling. Once he goes there, he finds out it is a 100-watt bulb. Suppose if it was a 1,000-watt bulb, you would have been able to see it 5 kilometers away. What does it mean? That light energy is going. The cosmos and the atmosphere is not only full of light, sound, energy, there is Atma energy also. You see an ant going, you see an elephant going, somebody stamps that ant, the ant dies, some lion comes and hits that elephant, the elephant dies. After 10, what you saw as living, moving bodies, after 10 minutes, you see that there are two dead bodies. What is common in them? Oh, they are dead. The life is gone. So what is the size of life? What is the size of Atman? Elephant doesn't have a huge Atman which you would have seen. The ant doesn't have a small Atman which you cannot see. It is theoretically said the size of the Atman is 1 millionth of a millimeter. Where are they going? They both departed. Where have they gone? They are circulating everywhere before it could take a rebirth. So the atmosphere and what we inhale inside is not just the oxygen, it is the complete energy, all kinds of energy. So pranayama is one of the basic health tonics. If adapted, keeps a person, elongates his life in a healthier way. That's the beauty of the mahatva of pranayama. And these energies which are floating in the air, unlike the cell tower or the microwave energy, they are not harmful. They are energizing our living beings. So, then how many times we breathe? We breathe 15 times a minute. If you calculate, it comes to 21,600 times a day. Tell me in real life, how many of us are really thinking that we are breathing 21,600 times? We never give it a thought. It keeps happening. It doesn't ask your permission. So our lifespan is estimated to be 100 years. Imagine a dog, uncontrolled, 70 times a dog breathes. How long a dog lives? 14 years, 15 years. I don't know how many of you know, a tortoise, it comes out of the water, opens the mouth, very controlled, deep breath, 2 times in a minute. Any of you know what is the life of a tortoise? Its average life is 300 to 700 years. And I was told there are tortoises living 1,000 years also. So breathing is so important. Breathing scientifically is important, breathing the number of times. So it is for us to decide that 21,600 times a day breathing, whether I complete it in 4 hours or drag it to 24 hours, depends on our health. Because if a person is sick, if they have flu or something, we can see him breathing very deep, that means he is sick. And there are people who have verbal diarrhea who keeps on talking. You can imagine how many times they miss their breath out and become unhealthy. So, mita, you have to talk moderate, you have to practice pranayama for a good health. There are several pranayamas. It's anulom vilom, that is alternative breathing, is a basic pranayama. If you do not do any other pranayama, learn anulom vilom and practice it from a slow speed. In a couple of weeks, reach a big rhythm, your whole respiratory system will get clear. The respiratory system gets infected with the dust what goes in. You know how the pearl is formed, right? The pearl, there is a speck of dust which is going in between two shells, and the worm gives the saliva and the coating becomes a pearl. The same way, the road tire, the road dust, and the tire dust and so many dust in the atmosphere, it goes inside our respiratory system, it gets sticked to the mucus layer and the coating is formed. So our respiratory system gets filled up with phlegm, which is very difficult to come out, which you have to take it out. The health of the respiratory system improves just by anulom vilom. There are about 9 major pranayamas: anulom vilom, nadi pariksha, nadi shodhana, kapala bhati, bastrika, and then kantashuddhi pranayama for those who have a voice problem, and brahmari for memory and sleep apnea, and Shutali and Shitkari for keeping your blood and body cool in summer months. These are major pranayamas and there are any number of extensions. See, the yoga sutras which are made are couplets of two lines which are expanded by various acharyas as per the imagination. Just like Bhagavad Gita, 700 verses are transformed into thousands and thousands of volumes of books. Yoga sastras also, you have abundant number of books. I will suggest that you get introduced to the basic course somewhere and then analyze your specific health problem and take proper guidance and start the pranayama. It is never late, it is never too early for starting a pranayama and yoga. The earlier you start is better. You don't have to wait for a diabetes or an arthritis or a cervical spondylitis or any of these to attack, so that then you should go to learn pranayama. By consistent practicing from the early times, can put all these diseases at bay. We have cure in our backyard, but we reach for antibiotics, we reach for allopathy, we reach for homeopathy, we reach for everything. Forget Lakshmipathy. That is the only thing. So you have to practice at the earliest time possible, then your health and prosperity is going to improve. With the traffic congestion and the digitization of this current world, many executives are finding it very, very difficult to find time. So what I have done is I have put up a small write-up which we are enclosing there, so that you don't have to find time for doing meditation yoga. How you too can become a yogi right from the time you leave the bed, right from the time you leave the bed, conduct the day and reach the bed. If those who are interested can start with that and take advantage of this natural wealth available, Veda, yoga, pranayama in our country, and live with happy, prosperous life. So friends, I hope I kindled enough your interest, and unfortunately the time constraint does not permit me to demonstrate any of the, these things, and those who are interested can always approach me for any help. I pray to God on all your behalf for your excellent health and prosperous life. I am ever indebted to Professor Kashyap, Sakshi and my great friend Raghunath Jagirdar for having given me this opportunity to be in front of you, to share my couple of thoughts to you. If I am very amateurish, please bear with me. Those who are not introduced, take advantage of this introduction. So with this, I come to the conclusion. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Thank you.
That was Sri T.K. Jagannathan with his presentation on self-governance, yoga, pranayama and meditation. We all join in thanking him, and I have the privilege of calling upon Dr. Raghunath. Sri Bindu Madhav Jhagirdar will now honor Sri T.K. Jagannathan for his excellent presentation. He mentioned that he was amateurish. Now, if amateurish is so good, we can imagine how he will be if he is professional. So we wish that he goes professional and share his wonderful expertise as a trainer with all of us. And I invite every one of you to join us in persuading him to do a workshop along with Sakshi in the coming years and months. We thank him for an excellent wake-up call. That is how I like to call it. And he has made a very complicated thing will sound so simple and beautiful. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is another example of excellent corporate self-governance. Thank you, Mr. Jagannathan.